Good morning. An introduction. We have Mike Firbank, who is the area dean of the Mercy Deanery, taking our service this morning. We've had a walk through, so we should be all right, shouldn't we, Mike? You may notice most of the decorations have gone. Thank you for the people who came on Friday and helped clear up. You may notice that the crib is still here. Somebody asked whether we should move it. I said, no, the wise men have been working the way here, and it would be a great shame if they arrived this morning to find it had gone. So the wise men are now in the crib. It's just been pointed out that it's rather a bit cold this morning. You will notice on the notices that it says knee blankets from the snow knitting group. If you are cold, there are some blankets available. If you talk to the nice people at the back, they will get you one. Okay, so thank you.
Privilege and pleasure to be here. This is my first time leading a service here. It will definitely not be my last. You are a church in a benefice in what's called vacancy. In a vacancy, the area dean steps in the background as kind of like your supply incumbent. So I'm going to be helping church wardens across this benefice work very swiftly and quickly through a plan for finding your new incumbent. And I have a fantastic new, or we have a fantastic new archdeacon who is very keen to make sure that is fulfilled by the end of this calendar year. So I am hoping, and it's not a promise, but I am hoping and expecting that by Christmas you will be led by a new leader. The rest we will work out as we go along. But I am a bit of a stranger and a foreigner in your midst, and we're going to be looking at strangers and foreigners in our midst, the Magi, later on. I'll tell you a little bit more about myself when we come to that, because when you're a stranger or a foreigner, it's good to share something of your story with people so they can start to kind of get a sense of who you are. But let's worship Almighty God with a fantastic hymn as we begin with 83.
Thank you.
What a great way to start Epiphany. Thank you. We are gathered as God's people in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My friends, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We say together, we have gathered together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit and strengthened by sharing God's gifts, we may give ourselves to the service of God and all his people. Please sit or kneel. Let's just take a moment to consider the week that has been, or the week that's ahead. Anything we need to leave in the past, anything that's concerning us for the future. Let's be still. Jesus said, before you offer your gift, go and be reconciled. As brothers and sisters in God's family, we confess together, asking our Father's forgiveness. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought and word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who in Jesus Christ has given us a kingdom that cannot be destroyed, forgive you your sins, open your eyes to God's truth, strengthen you to do God's will, and give you the joy of his kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Friends, we turn to celebrate and sing the Gloria. collect for Epiphany. Creator of the heavens, who led the Magi by a star to worship the Christ child, guide and sustain us, that we may find our journey's end in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We sit for our first reading, please.
Isaiah 60, verse 1-6. Isaiah gives hope to the people who have returned to their land after the exile. They will be once more become a great nation, honored with gifts from other nations. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together, they come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your hearts shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense, and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. If you're able to stand, we continue with our sung worship with hymn 88, How Brightly Shines the Morning Star.
No. my salvation.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Saint Matthew. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born king of the Jews? For we observed his star at his rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea. For so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there, ahead of them, went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. They knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
I speak in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please, friends, please sit down and be comfortable. They're quite cute, really, aren't they? I've got one of these knitted sets as well at home, and they're really, really lovely. So I want to talk a little bit about foreigners and strangers, and first of all, lay a kind of theological foundation, because for God, for the Lord, there's no such thing as a foreigner. There's no such thing as a stranger. There are no foreign lands for God. He knows all of us. We are all his children. Epiphany, I like to think of as the boo moment, because it means surprise, doesn't it? Surprise. There are no surprises for God. None whatsoever. But there are plenty for us. And last year, there have been a few surprises, plenty of shocks, plenty of things to be worried about, plenty of things that freeze the rational mind and put us in a place of anxiety. And when people are in a place of anxiety, sometimes, not you, but sometimes people can behave very, very badly or very oddly and find themselves responding in a way that if they'd had the headspace, they wouldn't have previously done that. So into town come a whole gaggle of people, looking very strange, acting very strange, and there is a commotion, and it just upsets everybody. I was in Dovedale. This was just before, I think, COVID struck. It was a lovely summer's day. We were there as a family. So a little bit about me. I will kind of do digressions and rabbit holes. It's just how I am. So my family, I have three children, Peter, Andy, and Paige. Peter's just graduated from Durham, and he's now working for the Cabinet Office. Andy has started his second year as an engineer in Malaysia. I think he landed after a 30-hour flight at some point this morning. I got a message about 2 a.m. And my daughter, Paige, who's 16 going on about 40. And she's the one I always take instruction from. Never cross your daughter. We were there, Dovedale, beautiful day, lots of people having picnics, and into the mix there's this huge commotion, and you can hear it because there's about 200 of them, and when 200 people turn up en masse to Dovedale, you know. And it's a beautiful collection of Muslim families who've come to celebrate the end of a particular festival, and they've come with amazing food, and it just smells and looks fantastic. And me being nosy, that's why I'm a vicar, apart from the free house, I notice what's going on. I'm always looking at what's going on. I mean, I was a primary school teacher before I was a vicar, so I'm always looking around and trying to read the room. And you can see there are some people who, oh, this is lovely, and there are other people, and I'm talking about white people now, who just look on with suspicion, as if their space has been invaded by foreigners. Their space and their quiet has somehow been taken over. Not their space in the first place. You can't book a spot in Dovedale. And everyone was welcome. Everyone was welcome. Our Magi, whoever they were, whatever they were not particularly welcome when they arrive. They're upsetting the natural order. Now, if we unpack who they are, well, there's some good reasons perhaps why they're not welcome. I mean, frankly, these people, whoever they are, men and women, this huge gaggle of people, probably ought to have been taken outside the city wall and stoned. I mean, they're evil. They read the stars. That's against Old Testament scripture. It's heretical. It's wrong. It's not to be allowed. They follow a star. Clearly against Old Testament scripture. They're foreigners coming into a very febrile environment. This is a Roman-occupied part of the world. They're coming from a non-Roman-occupied part of the world. The Romans do not like new things. The Jewish people at that time didn't like new things either. It was a very delicate balance of power and dynamics. And in come these star-following foreigners whom nobody recognizes. I think the thing which redeems them slightly for the moment in the eyes of the puppet king is, where's the king been born? And it just changes the whole dynamics of the conversation. Suddenly, they've got something that the puppet king wants. It's not a welcome, doesn't really want to know about them. They've just got something that he wants. And we know the rest of the story and the genocide that happens later on in Bethlehem. It's quite an appalling story of how not to welcome people, how to be quite shut down in your approach, how to let fear and anxiety rule, and not to stand on a solid theological foundation, a solid biblical foundation that I hopefully began with, which is, for the Lord there is no such thing as a stranger. There is no such thing as a foreigner. There are no surprises. All of his children are all of his children, and he loves all of them, whomever they are and wherever they've come from, and for that matter, being a church that believes in repentance and forgiveness, whatever they've done, whatever they've done, his arms continue to be welcoming and open. Open to receive and open for that embrace. That's not the kind of welcome that this gaggle got. What do we do with that? What do we do with that as a country or as a country? If I was getting all political, I'd say, well, there's a whole load of people who need a welcome who probably aren't getting one right now. Those who have been here for some time and those who are trying to get here. What do we do with that for us locally? What is it within us that is shutting down or shut down? What aspects of if we were in a better place might we find ourselves more open to welcoming others or welcoming new ideas? As an ex-teacher, I found myself going back to my teaching practice many, many times, and most of teaching is not about teaching. It's about culture change. It's about taking the people in front of you and leading them from one place to another. Educare, education, to lead from one place to another. In fact, that's all we do really in church life, is take people from one place and try and lead them to another. It's discipleship, it's growth, it's what it is to be a learner. But it's difficult stuff, especially when people are full of anxiety and fear, from cost of living to where's my church going to be in 10 years? But in all of that, again, I say, there are no surprises for God. God knows everything. He has everything. He has us. He simply invites us to join him on that journey. But the reason I think this story is so important to us is when we find ourselves in a place of anxiety or fear or worry or holding on to something from the past, it's really difficult to be taken on any journey whatsoever because we find ourselves stuck. Stuck emotionally, stuck mentally, stuck spiritually. And so it might be that Epiphany for us in 2023 is an absolutely ideal and perfect time to say, Lord, I'm terrified. But I'm ready for whatever you've got in store for me. Whatever you've got in store for me. I'm ready to start listening again. I'm ready to start opening my heart and my mind again to whatever comes next, to whatever new thing, whatever surprises you've got for me. And in that, There's no skill required, there's no training required, there's no licensing required. It's just a simple choice where we say yes. Yes to the epiphanies in 2023. Yes to whatever might be new. Or whatever might be old that the Lord wants to remind me of again and say, do you remember? Do you remember? So my challenge for each of us on Epiphany and for you as a church in vacancy is this. Are you willing to make that choice? Are you willing to say yes to that? Yes to your Lord. Yes to whatever he has in store this year. Yes to the journey that he wants to take you on. Yes to wherever he wants to take you. And I don't believe the Lord ever takes us beyond what we're capable of. Sometimes we might feel it. But he is a loving God. He takes us on slow, small baby steps, like the ones at Dovedale, the stepping stones across. Even a small child can get across those steps. And they're large steps, aren't they? Yeah? If you take them slowly, you're not going to fall in. You just go one at a time. And no one's going to rush you. But the invitation is to choose to go from one side to the other with God. Because you know as well as I do, when we're traveling and walking around this beautiful part of the world, you only have to go to the other bank to look back and see a very different view from the one where you were. So again, my friends, let's just be still before we stand and say the beautiful words of the creed, the belief of the church for many hundreds of years. Just be still and to yourself be true. And decide whether you are willing to just say yes. Yes to whatever the Lord has in store for you in 2023. Friends, if you're able to stand, would you stand with me and let us affirm our faith in the words of the creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please sit or kneel as we're led in our prayers.
Our response today to Lord in your mercy is hear our prayer. Lord God and Father, as we start this season of Epiphany, we are thankful that you revealed yourself to the wise men and to the world. You did not stay hidden and unapproachable. We thank you that you came down to meet us where we were and that you were not distant. We pray that today you will speak to us in a way that we can understand and that we receive more joy from knowing you and your Son. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, as we remember the calling upon our lives to be in service to our neighbors and to our community, show us how to live every day and move us closer to your vision of the world. Lord, we pray for our church and church leadership and the wider Christian community in this country and around the world, and remember those who are persecuted for their faith. May we stand strong in the face of secular opposition to our beliefs. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jesus came as the Prince of Peace and brought a message of peace for all people. We remember all countries where there is war or conflict, especially in Ukraine, and pray for all the families in our community who are far from home and affected by the war. Help us to be the peacemakers in our homes and our work so that peace, rather than hatred and evil, will be more pervasive. We lift up King Charles and our government and leaders around the world so that they may make courageous and brave decisions on behalf of the people, especially in the areas of strikes and the healthcare service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those in our community who are isolated and alone. May they know your presence so that they feel less alone. And may we all think about people who we know that might need companionship and relationships, especially at this dark and bleak time of the year. Help us to be the means through which others can see Christ. We pray for the sick and suffering and all who are experiencing a darkness of spirit. Grant them healing and peace. Let them know your presence and that you are with them in their suffering. We pray for those families who have recently been touched by bereavement. Where there is grief and sorrow, bring comfort to them and reassure them of the resurrection and your unending compassion. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we move into the coming week and this new year, may we know that you listen to our prayers and answer our request. We say together, Heavenly Father, you have promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, that when we meet in his name and pray according to his mind, you will be among us and hear our prayer. In your love and mercy, fulfill our desires and give us your greatest gift, which is to know you, the only true God, and your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace, my friends. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We offer one another a sign of peace. Are we omitting the fourth verse from this one?
Yes.
Thank you. Our offertory hymn is hymn 86 from the Eastern Mountains, Pressing On They Come. We are not singing verse 4. We're not singing verse 4. Thank you. Generous God, creator, redeemer, sustainer, at your table we present this money, symbol of the work you have given us to do. Use it, use us in the service of your word, to the glory of your name. Amen. With this bread that we bring, we shall remember Jesus. With this wine that we bring, we shall remember Jesus. Bread for his body, wine for his blood. Gifts from God to his table we bring. We shall remember Jesus. Amen. My friends, the Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Friends, please sit as we continue. Revealing God, you sent the light of a star, and in that light we see the truth of who you are and the truth of who we are. Like the Magi, you call us to worship you, but like the Magi, we mistake where you truly belong and where we truly belong. Yet in Revelation, you direct us to yourself, and in incarnation, you meet us in yourself. You become what we are, that we might become what you are. And so you draw us to the company where your angels gather, and around your eternal throne, singing their hymn of unending praise. God of wonder, as the Magi brought gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, so we bring these gifts of bread and wine. In those gifts we see your grief at the way we crucified your Son, the Holy One among us, but also the wonder of how you raised him to be our King in glory forever. Send down your Holy Spirit that we may discover what it means to be of you and in you, that this bread of honest toil and this wine of joyous celebration may be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who at supper with his disciples took bread, gave you thanks, broke the bread and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took that cup, and again when he gave you thanks, he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. God of wisdom, as the Magi brought gold, bring your whole church, living and departed, to the vision of your glory. As the Magi brought frankincense, infuse all who seek you with the beauty of your holiness. As the Magi brought myrrh, embrace all who suffer, until the time comes when you flood the whole creation with justice and mercy. In this banquet, restore us in your image, surround us with your company, and prepare us for your freedom, that we may come to resemble your Son, through whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in glory. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
As this bread is broken, so may we be broken. As Christ was broken and resurrected, so may we be made whole. My brothers and sisters in Christ, so let us draw near with faith to receive all that God offers us through the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us share together in remembrance that Christ died and lives for us today, and be fed by his spiritual gifts freely offered us, the gifts of God for the people of God. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Would you like to receive that? The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Wendy.
Friends, let us say together, you have opened to us the scriptures, O Christ, and you have made yourself known in the breaking of the bread. Abide with us, we pray, that blessed by your royal presence, we may walk with you all the days of our life, and at its end behold you in the glory of the eternal Trinity, one God forever and ever. Amen. So, Stephen, have we got any notices? Are we going to do a double act? We've done that. Oh, that's fantastic. Well, I'll do a couple. So going forward, my friends, my intention is to make this benefice a little bit of a second home for myself. The thing I love about being area dean is I have zero authority wherever I go. So I hopefully come with a smile, a need for coffee, lots of it, but advice and guidance. And my job, as I see it, is to support parishes however they best feel they need to be supported. And if there needs to be a question or a challenge, I'll put it in. But it's only there as advice and guidance. You don't have to listen to a thing I say. So hopefully that gives you the freedom to listen to everything I've got to say, because you don't have to take any heed of it whatsoever. We have a really lovely deanery leadership team. We meet weekly to talk through all the issues across the deanery. Our commitment is that this benefice is number one on our priority list for the entire of 2023. And as area dean, it's my number one priority for the entirety of 2023 until I see a new person licensed here. And then that commitment continues to them and their family until they feel settled in. So that's my commitment to you. And I do hope to be seeing you more often in a number of different, you know, ways and places, and perhaps midweek and all the rest of it. If you ever want to get in touch with me, you are more than welcome to as your area dean. My contact details in the public domain, and I generally get back to people within about 5 seconds. I live with my phone, so I'm one of those. But I'm staying for tea and coffee afterwards, so please, by all means, if you've got anything you want to ask today, please, by all means. But otherwise, contact me any time you want to. As we come to the dismissal and our final song, it is my custom when I lead worship to be saying to people, what is your takeaway for today? What is it that you wish to leave this beautiful building with? Is it a question? Is it a hope? And let's be honest, like David in the Psalms, is it a worry? But what is it? What is your takeaway? Because as you leave the place, the Lord goes with you. What is your takeaway? If you can, would you stand with me? May the light of Christ pierce the darkness of this world. May the love of Christ lift your spirits and gladden each day. May the peace of Christ fill your hearts and mind. May Christ, our Saviour, walk by your side today and all your days. And the blessing of our eternal God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you now and forevermore. Amen. Let's end our act of worship together with 91. saints, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. It's tea time.